Thank you.
head one to the back. Over. What?
Gourd.
So before we read a couple poems, I want to take you back to how this whole thing started.
It was in the summer. I didn't really know what I was doing. I had a couple of Shel Silverstein poems, and I was just like going for it. It was hot. We were in the library at this point, and we burned through the poems. You know, I'm thinking, all right, we'll read these poems. It'll take a while. I don't know how all these students will be together. And we burn through them, and there's 10 minutes left. And I thought, man, I still got 10 minutes. What am I gonna do? This is awful, right? This is all gonna fall apart. It's hot, I'm sweating, they're sweating. And I'm like trying to reach through my little bag of tricks and find something when one of the students just goes, hey, aren't we gonna write now? Yeah, I mean, of course we're gonna write. This is a writing workshop, this is what we're here for. So then we did. So. Some students needed some scaffolding from the staff. They either like dictated their poems or got some writing support. Some students wrote independently. But the student who came up and asked me about it came with a really wonderful haiku-ish piece. And it's, is the pizza high or is the pizza low? Nobody knows. Right, it's very good. And so after this, I started thinking to myself that now I need to find more challenging work. You know, I can't just give them the usual canon. I can't just give them Mo Willems over and over again, Shel Silverstein over and over again. So I started searching for some different options. And I came across this really wonderful essay by Lemony Snicket called All Good Slides Are Slippery. And this is just a quote from that I'm gonna read, kind of keep in the back of your mind. So it's, I am suspicious of anything written specifically for children. Things written by someone who is thinking only of children far too often have an unfortunate tone. If you have ever seen an adult hunch over and begin talking to a child in the high-pitched voice of an irritating sympathetic, then you know the tone I mean. It is a tone that takes the fun out of everything, even everything fun. And I mean, admittedly, it's a little harsh, but let me kick it. Got his celebrity from writing a series of books about really awful, macabre, murderous things happening to a group of orphans. So he's not one to pull punches. But within this essay, there's a lot of really wonderful poems that he gives a sort of reading list of works that might be appropriate for children that weren't necessarily written for kids. And so this next piece is one that was part of that essay. It's called Monsters by Dorothea Lasky. And Dorothea Lasky is part of Columbia's poetry and her favorite program. She's a professor there. So take a second to read this, and I'll read it out. And when you read it, or when you listen, think about how it might be appropriate for the kids in your class, and how it might be appropriate within this setting. What about it makes it challenging, and what about it might appeal to some of our kids? This is Monsters. This is a world where there are monsters. There are monsters everywhere. Raccoons and skunks. There are possums outside. There are monsters in my bed. There is one monster. He is my little one. I talk to my little monster. I give my little monster some bacon, but that does not satisfy him. I tell him, shh, don't growl, little monster. And he growls, oh boys. And he wants something from me. He wants my soul. And finally, giving in, I give him my gleaming soul. And as he eats my gleaming soul, I am one with him and stare out his eye pits. And I see nothing but white. And then I see nothing but fog, and the white I had seen before was nothing but fog. And there is nothing but fog out of the eyes of monsters. Real world, be touched by ancient, possible, but you know, you touch bacon. things that can be interacted with, that can be seen. And when I did this piece, one of the first questions that I was asked was, what does a person look like without a soul? Which I think is a really marvelous, poetic question in and of itself. You know, what does it mean to not have a soul? Does it mean you passed on? Does it mean you live a life without a soul? What does a soulless life look like? And these kind of more challenging thoughts, these more complex emotions, are important to offer this group. I think as an educator, one thing I struggle with is the difference between protecting and respecting a student's emotions. I think it's easy to feel overprotective. But I also think that in offering these spaces to explore these more complex emotions through language, it's a kind of respect as well as a kind of protection to offer these kids. Because they do encounter sadness, they do encounter jealousy, they do encounter joy, these complex emotions. I mean, friendship, if you've never seen a friendship be complex, just stop down the sixth time. You know, there's so much that these kids experience that we really can't take for granted. And so in challenging them with these poems, I wanna offer them a space to do that. You know, and it's kind of dark. You know, I see nothing but fog. The white I had seen before was nothing but fog. And there's nothing but fog out of the eyes of monsters. There's something very dark and menacing to that, right? But these kids are aware. One of my favorite stories to tell is when this parentor came in. And so this parentor was there, and we were all starting to share work. And it was this amazing moment in which everyone was actually willing to sit and listen and like, be engaged as people share their stuff. And one of my students there, who doesn't usually share, was ready to share his piece of art, right? He's stoked, wicked stacked, ready to go. And parentor was in. They holds up his picture, and it's titled Death. And he goes, this is Andrew. And Andrew is shooting Fred. And this is Fred's blood. Kids are smiling, he's smiling, the parents are looking at me like I've done something wrong. Oh my god, that's great, I'm gonna get fired. And this is how it all ends. But the truth is, I can't stop what the students might hear, or on the screen, or see in the news, or whatever other media they access. But what I can offer is a safe place to explore that language, and ways to appropriately use it to cope. And in doing so, hopefully help them move up. You know, in that parentor example, I'd rather have that student draw and express that emotion in the safe space that internalizes it. You know, and I want to validate that expression. I want to honor his ability to share that among his peers, because it's an incredibly brave and incredibly moving thing to do. It takes a lot of courage. There's a lot of fear surrounding it. So, another time I was doing this, it was like September. I had gotten through the summer, and I kind of had things on the roll, right? Like, I knew how things were going. And a student came up and was like, oh, Donnie, can you teach us about irony? I guess. And the image that immediately jumps to mind when I think of irony is like, fire, like, I'm fired. I'm not going to tell that to this kid. So, you know, how do you teach irony? It's kind of a complex thing to teach. But I found this Shel Silverstein poem, right? It's called Fear. And I think the irony is pretty evident. So fear. Barnabas drowning was scared of drowning, so he never would swim or get into a boat, take it back across the moat. He just sat day and night, the door locked tight, and the windows nailed down, shaking with fear that a wave might appear, and cried so many tears that they filled up the room and he drowned. Right, so the irony in it, so it's pretty obvious, and I was all stoked to teach and use this, and they had the poem in front of them with the drawing, and it was going to be great and amazing, and then all of a sudden one of them was just like, I'm afraid of cruise ships. Started for me, and staff does it. You know, I volunteer. I'm afraid of that. but when you put me on anything bigger than a step stool, I freak out. So I offered that. And we put together this really amazing list of fears. Here it is. It's hard to read. I'm sorry about that. But this is our list of fears from that workshop. So we had airplanes crash / helicopter crash, pigeons, a ship sailing, dogs, spiders, heights, rabbits, cockroaches, snakes, fish, bees, trying new food. mosquito bites, death, cats, Five Nights at Freddy's, ghosts, haunted houses, certain types of Pokemon, zombies, and my sister. So we made this list, and then we used it as our writing prompt for a kind of cool down activity. We were able to turn it around, and then write about our fears. We were able to share them with each other and create something from them. That's one of the major goals of this, is being able to self-advocate that way. You know, maybe next time, instead of becoming dysregulated or crisising over community food, someone who was a part of this workshop can have the inner resources to look back to a time when they shared their fears and just say, you know, I'm afraid of new types of foods. Or someone's getting upset about the impending family day, they can express, you know, I'm afraid of my sister and what my sister visiting means. And it becomes something totally different, that instead of internalizing, they now have the language and they have the resources and the space to share that. Because ultimately, you know, poetry doesn't mean that much. It's a lot of really nice, sometimes fun, flowery language. But poetry, at its core, is just something that I use to express things.